Hello everybody. Today we are talking about secure messengers and also the desktop messengers which you can link to the smartphone application, and also about the problem usability versus security. But first of all, I want to introduce ourselves. So my name is Christoph, and this is my colleague David.
Hello.
We both graduated with a bachelor degree in IT security at the University of Applied Science in St. Pölten. If you want to get some more information, just visit the website. And we're also currently studying master in information security, also at the same university, and also work for a small company called CrossSec in Vienna since more than 2 years. Where we do mainly penetration testing, also code auditing, and also social engineering tests, which is quite interesting. So this is where we come from. This mark is where St. Pölten is located. There is also our university located, and next to St. Pölten there's Vienna, where we work. Yeah, what we are talking about today, first of all, I want to show you some recap about what happened the last year regarding secure messaging. Then we talk about the problem usability versus security, and also provide an example where the provider decided to make the messenger more usable, but which affects the security. We also conducted a usability study for the Signal Messenger last year, which we want to present the results. And then we want to present the desktop messengers. So Signal and WhatsApp also have a desktop application, which you can link to your smartphone application. And how is the linking performed, and some general information about the desktop messengers. Also security issues and related general issues about the both messengers. And the final part is the conclusion. So I'll start with the recap. Last year there was in March, Signal decided to rename also the Axolotl protocol, which is used by the Signal Messenger, to Signal protocol, and they also renamed all other stuff that all the things are now named Signal, which is kind of nice. Then, which was a big step, WhatsApp decided to implement the end-to-end encryption protocol from Signal, so you can chat end-to-end encrypted in the Signal single chats or also in the group chats, which is very nice. I'm not sure how many of you know about the desktop version of Signal, but first of all, it was just closed, so you had to get an invite and then you can use it, but then they decided to get public. And now everyone can use this great desktop application. Also, Google decided to implement the end-to-end encryption protocol for Elo, so they have also another messenger. Then Facebook too. So all big companies decided to implement the great protocol. Then Signal changed their verification page. Previously, there were two fingerprints you have to compare, which we see later on. But now you have a single safety number, which you have to compare, and then you can verify each other. And Signal also decided to implement some sort of censorship circumvention. So some countries decided to block the Signal Messenger, and then they implemented some nice stuff, and now they can also use the Signal Messenger too. And this year, there was the article about the WhatsApp backdoor, which we also will discuss later on and describe what that really is. Usability versus security, so that's a common problem. And we'll start with this WhatsApp backdoor. So the Guardian posted an article about security researcher found a backdoor for WhatsApp. And what is this all about, and is this really a backdoor? So what WhatsApp tried to mitigate a problem is what should the messenger do if Bob is, for example, reinstalling the application and Alice is sending a message at the moment while Bob is reinstalling the message. So first of all, Alice sends a message to Bob, so Alice sends it to the server simply relays it to Bob, and then Bob has to reinstall the application due to some problems. And in this time, Alice decided to send another message, but the server can't forward this message to Bob because Bob is not online at the moment. And after Bob finished the installation procedure, he published new keys. And then Alice simply gets these new keys. And now there is what is the guardian calling the backdoor. The messenger simply re-encrypts the message with the new key and just send it to Bob. So yeah, maybe it's not the best solution, but the problem is, what should the messenger do with this message? Should it just ignore, or should there be some warning? And WhatsApp also has decided to use so-called non-blocking messaging. So if a key change occur, you get no notification, you get no prompt where you have to accept a new key. You simply get a notification if you enable this feature, and the messenger sends the message anyway, but you get the notification. Instead, in Signal, you have a prompt where they tell you, okay, there's a new key, do you want to accept it? And then it sends the message. And this problem, which we would call more recent problem. For a Signal, for example, this message simply got lost. So the Bob would never ever get this message, and yeah, that's not the best way how to handle this. We also want to show how this could be exploited by an attacker, for example. So as I already mentioned, Signal Alice sends a message. This can be multiple messages, and Bob is at the moment offline, so the server can't forward this message to Bob. And within this time slot, Mallory, which is the attacker, is able to register a WhatsApp account with the number of, with Bob's phone number, for example, if he uses SS7 vulnerability, or is able to get the verification code which is required to register an WhatsApp account. Get this code and simply registers, and then Alice gets the new keys, and Alice retransmits these messages and would be forwarded to Bob, to Mallory. But as you can see, there is this warning. WhatsApp prompts a notification, okay, a key change occurred, and yeah, there's something wrong, but you have no possibility to stop the, to cancel this sending. So yeah, these messages are get sent anyway. That's not the best solution, but I'm not sure if there is any other solution at the moment. So you can see they are texting. Then he writes an word. Bob is online message, so we have two ticks. The one tick means the message got delivered to the server, and the second tick means that the message is delivered to the other device. And the second one is only one tick. So the Bob is currently offline. And then Bob is now online again. And then you can see, okay, there's a second tick, and there is this notification, okay, the security code changed. And normally then you should verify each other and check if the the safety number is equal. Yeah. Next topic is about our usability study we conducted last year. So together with a colleague from the University of Vienna, we conducted a usability study. So we want to check out how usable is the messenger, and what are the problems, is it easy to handle. This was our threat model. So normally you send exchange messages between Alice and Bob. But the problem is the keys which are required to send messages are returned by the server. So if the signal server, for example, decides to return the wrong keys, where the server has access to the private keys, he could intercept the messages and simply re-encrypt it and forward it to Bob. So show you on another slide. This is how a man-in-the-middle attack could be performed. So Mary, in this case, exchanges public keys with Alice and with Bob. Then he has to calculate the secrets which are required to communicate later on. And then the exchange between Alice and Bob, end-to-end encrypted channel, and between Bob and Mary. And Mary simply forwards all these messages. So normally you get, in Signal, you get the notification, okay, the key changed, and you have to accept the new key. And this was also a task which the participants had to fulfill and to check how they react and what they are doing. So these were a task during the usability study. So just sending messenger to the other communication partner. The next step was to configure a master password. So you can configure a password to protect your local messengers, which are encrypted anyway, but you have to define a master password so no one other can decrypt it anymore. Then they had to create a backup of the local data, so the messengers they send and restore the backup. And then they had to send messages again. And then we run our man-in-the-middle attack and tested how they react. And also this was another part was to verify the other party. And yeah, always also how to perform the verification and what are the problems. And the last step was to interview the participants and ask them, okay, do you know what happened? Just happened. And yeah, it was quite interesting results. Yeah, we had 7 female participants and 21 male participants. They were between 18 and 35 years old. And we also had a questionnaire where we asked the people, okay, do you know something about privacy and security? And yeah, 7 told us, okay, they had no knowledge about this. 17, yeah, some knowledge, and 4, yeah, they have a lot of knowledge, but there were no experts which dealing with this every day or something like that. And yeah, about the background, so most of them used WhatsApp. Yeah, it's not a big surprise. But only one used Signal before. Yeah, here you can see the step where we started our man-in-the-middle attack. So they just exchanged those German messages, but doesn't matter. They communicate with each other, and then we started our man-in-the-middle attack. Then you get this red mark, and then you had to click on this message. Then you get the next page. Okay, some issues occurred, and you had to verify the other party communication partner. And this is the first problem. So many people thought, okay, as I told before, there was a step to verify the other party, and some people just thought, okay, there is the verify button, so if I click on this verify button, I verify the other party and everything is fine. But yeah, that's not really how verification should be performed. Yeah, when you click on this verify button and you get the next message, in this case you can accept a new key or cancel and maybe stop messaging. And it would also be possible to click on this, may wish to verify this content, and then you would have the possibility to verify the other partner. But no one of the participants clicked on this message, so yeah, they didn't see it, or I don't know. yeah, how the participants should verify each other. So you have this fancy button, the conversation settings. Then you have the button verify identity, and then you get this yeah, strange numbers and characters, and yeah, it's very difficult. When you see this for the first time, you think, okay, what should I do with these numbers? And then you have their identity, your identity, and yeah, so many people got confused and didn't know what to do. And yeah, it was also a big, it was very difficult just to get there, so to find all these steps to get there. And it was also be possible to simply scan the QR code, which is located there, so also not very easy to reach. Normally, if you scan this QR code, you get these two messages, these notifications, okay, it's verified or it's not verified. And when we run our man-in-the-middle tag, normally you should get the message, okay, not verified. And yeah, but what should you do after it's not verified is also hard to decide. So these were our results. Only 7 participants were able to verify each other, and the other 21 people didn't made it. And some participants simply asked in the chat, which got man-in-the-middle by us, so are you Bob, is everything okay? And then we just reply, okay, yeah, everything is fine. Or you had the option to ask the other guy into the room and ask, and some participants just ask, okay, hi, are you Bob? And then we said, okay, yeah, we are Bob. Maybe not the best option. So the problem is simply they don't know what this means, this verification, to verify the other party. And this is really hard to implement. So what's it simply, skip this part to accept a new key. So they simply show a notification, okay, the key changed, and then you could verify each other, but they don't force the people to accept the new key, because many people just hit, okay, yeah, I'm not sure what this is, and I think everything is fine. So then we also wrote a paper about that and added some recommendations. So as I already told, the verify button is not the best choice, so it should be renamed. And for example, show keys or, verify is confusing. Then they should redesign the verification page because the two fingerprints are not the best choice. And the QR code should be on the same page. You should get a help message. Okay, what should you do, and what is this all about? And also, it would be nice to have a verification status. So if you verified another people, then you should get a tick or some mark. Okay, you already verified these people. So if you have, I don't know, many contacts and started with a few of them, and then get later on back and want to verify the other people, and you don't know anymore which one you already verified, is a little bit difficult. So yeah, as I already mentioned in the recap section, they have now their safety numbers, and they also redesigned the verification page. So it's very nice. So they have the QR code at the same page. You have just the safety number, which has to be the same number on both devices. So you meet the other in person and check the number, for example. And you have a description, okay, what should you do and what this is about. So yeah, it's very nice, and yeah, well done. So next part is about the desktop messengers.
Yeah, thank you. Over the last couple of months, we had a look at two different desktop messengers. So we had a look at Signal Desktop, and we had a look at WhatsApp Web. So and we're going to start with Signal Desktop, and it looks like this. It's a Chrome extension, and it was released last year in closed beta, and you have to got an invite, and then like he mentioned in the recap session earlier this year, the beta is publicly available. So you have to install it via the Chrome Store, or you can build it yourself if you want. And yeah, how does it work? The main difference between Signal Desktop and WhatsApp Web is that Signal Desktop is a standalone application. So you need Chrome, but you can send messages without that the smartphone is online. So you really have the identity keys on your phone, but I'm going to explain this later. It uses QR codes to exchange the public keys which are needed to calculate the secrets, which are then further are used to encrypt the messages, and it's open source. So yeah, when you install Signal Desktop, then you have this QR code which you have to scan on your mobile phone to in order to link the device to your existing Signal account. So you need an existing Signal account which is registered to your phone number, and then you're going to scan this QR code. And now I'm going to explain how this works, and this is a little bit complicated. So first of all, the Signal Desktop client requests a UUID from the Signal server. This then after the Signal Desktop has this UUID, with which is then used to uniquely identify the Signal Desktop application, the Signal Desktop generates public and private keys, and then the Signal Mobile scans this QR code, and this QR code contains this public key. So now the Signal Mobile application has this public key, which got generated by the Signal Desktop, and then Signal Mobile requests this provisioning code, which is the verify code, which is similar to the verification code you get when you first install the Signal Mobile app. So like what you get via SMS or via phone call. Then Signal Mobile encrypts the identity and the provisioning code using the derived secret. So Signal Mobile, using this public key and a newly generated private key, is able to generate a shared secret. And then Signal Mobile sends this identity information to the Signal Desktop application. So here you can see the big difference. Signal Mobile is actually sending the private identity keys to the Signal Desktop, and that's why Signal Desktop is a standalone messaging application. So Signal Mobile can be offline, and you can send messages from Signal Desktop with your identity. So after that, the user gives some name to the Signal Desktop application, and then a new random password is generated, which is then used to authenticate to the Signal server. And using the provisioning code which got transmitted from the Signal Mobile application to the Signal Desktop, the Signal server is able to cross-check the provisioning codes on, so in order to match Signal Mobile and Signal Desktop to each other, so that it's the that they belong together. And then the Signal server replies with an device ID, which is then used later on to send messages to the Signal Desktop server, Signal Desktop client. Yeah, and then we're nearly finished. Signal Desktop creates new keys, adds this to the server. They are then later on needed to send end-to-end encrypted messages. And then the Signal Mobile is Signal Mobile application is able to send the contacts which are stored on the mobile phone and the group memberships to the Signal Desktop application, and then it's finished. Yeah. So how is this syncing working? So it's just a it's nothing fancy. It's just a normal Signal message, because Signal Desktop is a standalone application. You can send Signal messages to the Signal Desktop client, and yeah, the contacts and the group memberships are sent to the Signal Desktop via a normal Signal message. So nothing fancy is happening here. So the first kind of vulnerability, which is a known problem, Signal Desktop, and not only Signal Desktop, Signal Mobile also has this problem, leaks phone numbers and device IDs. So when you are able to man in the middle, like the TLS traffic between the client and the server, you are able to enumerate the numbers, the phone numbers of the messaging partners, and also the device IDs. So you can see here, you can say, well, the first one is it's this number, then this number, then this number, and then you can match to each number, you can match the device IDs. So, for example, here, those three, they have 2, 4. They have the device ID 2, 4. Then the second one has 2, 4, 5, and this one has only 5. So you can say, okay, this phone number has 3 devices linked to it. The first has 2 devices linked to it, and the third has only 1 device linked to it. And due to the fact that the device IDs are like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, you can say, okay, the last one has probably uninstalled the app for 4 times, and now he made his 5th attempt so to install the app. And another problem is that the phone number is included in the GET request. So I don't know if you know, but when Signal uploads the contacts to the server, it does not upload it in plain, it uploads it in a hashed format to prevent this kind of information leakage. But then when you send messages, it's included in the GET request, and probably they store it in log files or somewhere. So the Signal server runs in the Amazon cloud, and I think that Amazon may have some logs, so maybe Amazon is able to like enumerate all the Signal users and the phone numbers and the device IDs. So I see this as kind of a problem, and I don't know why they are doing this in a GET request. They could simply use POST, and then it's not included in the log files normally. Yeah. Then we had a look what happens when we man in the middle the communication with Signal Desktop. And then you get, by default, you get like this notification, your safety number has changed, but like you can see it's not blocking, so you can just continue and you can send messages again, but it's not blocked, this outgoing message. If you want to have like this this blocking feature, then you can turn on this feature, like safety numbers approval, which means you have to approve that this safety number is the correct one before you can again send messages. And when you enable this feature, then you can send a message again after a man in the middle attack takes place, and then you have this red warning again, and then you have to accept the new key. And then you can verify the safety number, and then you can accept it, and then you're fine. So this was a short overview of Signal Desktop, and now we want to analyze the differences between Signal Desktop and WhatsApp Web. So WhatsApp Web looks like this, and it's a web application. So you can just simply go on the web app. It's web.whatsapp.com. And you can again scan a QR code, and yeah, the linking procedure I'm going to explain later. But it's not that complicated like with Signal Desktop. The characteristics, like yeah, it's mobile dependent, so you need a mobile phone which has an active internet connection. So the WhatsApp web application sends all the messages to the mobile, and then the mobile relays it to the other party. Again, it's using a QR code for calculating the necessary secrets. It's closed source, of course, and yeah, there are some privacy concerns which we can discuss later. Yeah, here we have this QR code. You have to scan this in the WhatsApp application, and here you have this small remark. I don't know if you can read it, but it says to reduce mobile data usage, connect the phone to Wi-Fi. So this means, okay, the phone needs to be connected to internet, and due to the fact that the messages are uploaded from the smartphone to the web application, you should activate Wi-Fi in order to reduce the data charges. So the linking procedure works like the following. The WhatsApp web client generates key pairs and generates this QR code, which again contains this public key. And the WhatsApp web client also periodically updates a parameter which is called ref, which is like a reference for the WebSocket, which is established later on. And then the WhatsApp client scans the QR code, which contains this reference parameter, the public key, and the browser ID, which is again needed for identifying the WhatsApp web application. Then WhatsApp is able to generate the key material, which is needed. And here we have a difference in comparison to single desktop. WhatsApp web calculates two secrets, so two symmetric keys. One symmetric key, which is called the message encryption key, which is then actually used to symmetrically encrypt the communication between WhatsApp web and WhatsApp mobile. And one key to encrypt the message encryption keys for transferring it from WhatsApp to WhatsApp web. So here, the message encryption keys are generated and then encrypted again with a new symmetric key and is then delivered to WhatsApp web, which is then able to decrypt the message encryption keys. And yeah, then WhatsApp web uploads the encrypted messages and the group contacts and everything to WhatsApp web. So as you can see, we have this mobile dependent WhatsApp web client, which uses a symmetric encrypted channel, a WebSocket channel, to communicate with the mobile client. So WhatsApp mobile uploads the chat history. So all the chats which are stored on the mobile are uploaded to WhatsApp web, and the images are stored inside the they are stored on the server in an encrypted format. And if an image is requested from WhatsApp from the user, then it's downloaded and it's decrypted locally. So yeah, in order to reduce data charges, of course. So as you can see here, that's when the WhatsApp web WhatsApp mobile client uploads the messages, and here you can see it's the WebSocket connection, and here you have the binary frames. So for encryption, yeah, it uses a symmetric key, like I told you before, and it's store. You can view this key in the Chrome debugging tools, and there is one issue. This key remains the same for the whole session. So if you don't unlink your device for a longer time, this key remains the same. So you don't have like future secrecy or forward secrecy or something like this. If this key gets compromised, a person with man in the middle capabilities is able to decrypt the messages which are exchanged between the mobile and the web application. So yeah, that's another point. Yeah, default settings and privacy concerns. Like, yeah, WhatsApp web uses the settings of the mobile app, because it's WhatsApp web is just a view to the mobile application. And as you can see, the default setting, we tested this on an iPhone application. It's like the share my account info. I don't know what this is, but it shares some data with Facebook. I don't know. I don't like it. It's enabled by default. The last scene and everything else is also enabled by default. So you can do like this tracking where when does this person go to sleep, when does he wake up, and so on. And yeah, the show security notifications is disabled by default. So yeah, So when you want to man in the middle WhatsApp communication, he won't recognize until he really verifies the other party. Default settings and privacy. Yeah, WhatsApp sends a whole bunch of data to the server regularly. So WhatsApp sends the battery level, so like 80% charge, or I don't know if it's plugged in or not. I don't know why they need this data. The location, the language settings, the exact version information, and this is really interesting, crash messages even when the application doesn't crash. So I don't know, but if you monitor the traffic, there are crash messages sent to the server, even if the application works perfectly, and the user won't recognize it. So it's happening in the background. Here we can see between those two messages, a man in the middle took place. Yeah, looks perfect. So no security notifications by default. So you should all enable this security notifications. If you have enabled this security notification, then you get the same information like in Signal Desktop, and then you can use the QR code to scan it, or you can even upload a code to which is then verified in the web application. But remember, it's non-blocking. So not like in Signal, where you have to manually resend the messages. When a man in the middle takes place and you have sent a bunch of messages, they're all sent away. So there is no blocking feature like Signal has it. So, and now Christoph is telling you something about the general issues we found in our research. And yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, general issues we discovered for both desktop applications. So, as David already mentioned, they are mainly built out of JavaScript. So, if an attacker can inject JavaScript code, they would perform a cross-site scripting attack. During our research, we did not discover such a vulnerability, but we just thought about, okay, what could an attacker do? An attacker would be able to steal messages because, they are locally stored. And the difference between what's a web and Signal Desktop, as David also mentioned, Signal is standalone and needs the identity keys, and what's a web simply transmit from the mobile application to the web application. And so the private identity keys are stored at the Signal Desktop application, and if an attacker can inject JavaScript codes, he also can extract the private identity keys. And if he performs a man-in-the-middle attack, you wouldn't get such a prompt, okay, the safety number changed, because the attacker has the right identity key and would be able to man-in-the-middle, and you wouldn't notice that. We think it's probably easier to exploit cross-site scripting within the WhatsApp web application, because it is a web application. The Chrome extension maybe isn't that easy to exploit, but who knows? And the next thing is, you need this QR code to link a desktop application to an existing account. And so what would be if an attacker simply injects a QR code? For example, you have unsecured communication and you have a man in the middle position, simply injects such a promo code and tell, okay, just scan it and you get free stuff, very nice. You have to scan this with your WhatsApp WhatsApp mobile application, or you just create a phishing website and place there such a QR code. So don't think like that. So free stuff, nice, I should take it. You should really think about it, and why should I ever scan such a QR code? And I don't know. So the last point is about the storage. So WhatsApp uses the local browser cache. It stores all the dates in clear text, in plain. Signal uses a so-called IndexedDB, which got introduced in HTML5. The problem is for the mobile application for Signal, you have the feature to encrypt all the messages, but this isn't available for Signal Desktop, so all the messages are plain text stored on your local disk. Yeah, which is not very nice, but there is no implementation yet to use IndexedDB and to encrypt all this data in an easy way. So the conclusion, as we heard in the recap section, so Signal protocol got widely adopted and used by several big messengers to use end-to-end encrypt chats. Yeah, WhatsApp focuses more on usability, so you have the security notifications disabled by default, so if there is a man-in-the-middle attack ongoing, you wouldn't notice that and until you verify data contact, and you have this retransmission problem, so we don't think that's a backdoor, but we think they should fix it or do it in another way, better way, maybe. Yeah, and Signal focuses on security, but yeah, this also makes it, in some case, more unusable. And yeah, you have the security notifications enabled by default, so the notifications, you can't disable these notifications, but you can disable this blocking mode, so that the messenger simply accepts the new key and just prompts the notification and tells, okay, there is a key change. All these warnings, which we saw in the study, in the usability study, can irritate the users, so they don't know what to do and are confused and simply click accept, because, yeah, what should I do else? And providers can always man-in-the-middle their users, because the keys are distributed via their servers, and if the servers return simply another key, you can only verify the other communication partner and check if the keys, if the identity is correct, and yeah, man-in-the-middle is always possible. Yeah, both desktop variants store their messages in clear text on the disk. And regarding privacy, yeah, WhatsApp makes money out of your data, so even if the chats are all end-to-end encrypted, you still have the metadata, which can be sold by Facebook, and yeah, it's not sure if you want that. Yeah, Signal focuses more on privacy, and yeah, so I think it's a big surprise that we as security-focused people prefer Signal over WhatsApp, and yeah, everyone should use Signal. Yeah, that was our talk. Thank you very much for your attention, and if you have questions.
Questions, and the slides are online there, so. All right, yeah, thank you.